of humor in a different branch of psychology, one that's probably the newest branch of psychology that's around. Yes, we're still growing new branches in the field of psychology. It still happens. And that's something called positive psychology. We actually used to have a whole class on positive psychology here at the University of Mount Union. I would love to do one. I don't have any room or time right now. But this is the one class where I get to talk about positive psychology, and this is the crossroads. So the last crossroads was health psychology with the humor. This is positive psychology. And since a lot of people haven't really heard of positive psychology, that's what we're going to actually spend today mainly talking about, is the background of positive psych, what it means, and then it'll launch you off into the research and the nitty-gritty details in the two easy-to-listen-to PowerPoint lectures that are prepared for you, which are, of course, right there, one and two. And that'll be it for the week. When we're done today, and I'm pretty sure we'll end at the exact same spot, I will post a little quiz for the week, and then we'll be done. Any questions? Home stretch, ladies and gentlemen. So I'm only going to see you three more times, which kind of seems bizarre. Some of you, three more times literally for the rest of your life. But so this week, 14, 15, and then part of 16. Humorology 4 is almost done. I'm actually going to probably send out a blast email about that later tonight. So be prepared. It's a fun one. So anyway, let's get started. I'm going to tell you a story, actually, to start out. It's a story about a guy named Nurse Bob. I'm looking around the room. Maybe one or two of you have heard this story before, so Macy's shaking her head. Do you remember the story of Nurse Bob? This actually isn't Nurse Bob. I Googled Nurse Bob, and that's what came up. And I chose to copy and paste this guy's picture on there. Sorry. Because he reminds me a lot of the real Nurse Bob. Nurse Bob is a real person. He's a real person that I met during my internship. My internship is what was at the Ohio State University Child and Adolescent Mental Health Unit. That's a mouthful. I spent a whole year there as an interning family therapist. What this place is, it's an intake hospital, which is rare. There's not many mental health intake hospitals in the United States, period. Much less one for kids. These were kids from 5 to 18 who would come in. They would typically stay 3, maybe 5 days max. It all depends on how long their insurance would pay until the insurance would say, nope, sorry, you can't stay there anymore. You're out of money. And these weren't just kids who, gosh, I'm having trouble in school, or I can't make any friends, or I'm feeling a little anxious now and then. These were, to get in this hospital, actually, there was not one kid in the hospital who wasn't suicidal or had attempted suicide at some point. In other words, these were real severe, the most severe of the severe mental illnesses that the kids are dealing with. That's who gets in, like a competition to get in. In fact, we actually had people from the tri-state area, Michigan. We had kids from Michigan, Tennessee, West Virginia, from all angles, because there's no other place for these kids to go. That's how few intake hospitals they are. Why am I telling you this? Well, just to kind of give you the context of what this place was like. There was a very, very highly stressful environment, nonstop. Obviously, it's open 24/7 because it's an intake hospital. But my day always started the same. I would get there on 7:30 in the morning, and the first thing that we would do is something called rounds. And rounds didn't mean going from room to room. It's about 30 beds, by the way, 30 kids that would stay there. Every morning, we would sit at this giant big table. We called it rounds because we all sat around the table, get it? And there'd be a psychiatrist, maybe two, some clinical social workers over here. In fact, my mentor, Janet, was a clinical social worker, so she was always kind of by my side. Then we had some psychologists, clinical counselors. Basically, at a table, at one table, you had the whole cornucopia of mental health sitting at this table so that we could go case by case. And we would talk about all our different perspectives and what we thought was the best way to help this kid, since we'd only probably see them for 72 hours. So that's what we did every morning. On my very first day there, I could tell two things. One observation was really clear, and that was everyone was in a really bad mood, or at least a very like, and, but it's a very serious place. I don't expect people to be laughing and joking and that sort of thing. But this was like hardcore, like, I felt like I just got dropped like in the middle of a war that was happening. And I wasn't really given any introduction or like, this is what's going to happen. It's, imagine yourself just plopping down and stuff just happening around you. And everyone's in that mindset of, let's say, just go, let's do it. That sort of thing. Okay, well, it makes sense because it's an insane hospital for kids with severe mental illness. The other observation that I made on the very first day, though, was this dude. And they just, everyone just called him Nurse Bob. He sat at the table, kind of catacorded to me. And the reason he stuck out to me is he kind of looked like that. In fact, his grin was a little bit different. He had a goofy mustache like that. Not a mustache, it was goofy, not judging, but it's kind of what it looked like. Just in a good mood. He just seemed fine. Like everyone else is like, oh, oh, oh. And Bob was just like, pleasant. Like relaxed, calm. All right, Bob. The other thing that I noticed, by the way, and that what really made him stick out, was he drank his coffee every morning out of a straw. That's nothing to do with Bob and nothing to do with the rest of the story, but just so you know, there's people on this planet that drink hot, and it's not iced coffee, it's hot coffee from Starbucks every morning. This coffee, exactly. I'm assuming he's really careful about his teeth or something. I have no idea. I never asked, I never inquired about that, which is amazing considering what I did inquire about. So anyway, that's where we're at. Stressful place, Nurse Bob's nice. So maybe, no surprise, I like Nurse Bob. We'd have lunch together every once in a while. To be honest, he was the one guy I could stand to kind of be around for more than 2 or 3 minutes because everyone was always there. But then I noticed my third observation on the unit happened maybe a couple weeks in. I'm not sure how many of you have been in a mental health hospital. That's what I'm trying to say. Mental health hospital for any reason whatsoever. But if you ever spend any time there, what you'll notice is that structure is everything. What I mean by structure is when things happen and how things happen. Every day, it's like the army, like lunch is now. It's at 11:30, it's not 11:31, and it always comes in the same cart, and everything goes in the same order. Order and structure is very important in a mental health hospital for adults and for kids. So things run like clockwork. So if something keeps happening every day, you're probably going to notice because it's going to feel like part of the routine. Well, one little routine that I picked up on, which kind of sat uneasily for me because I was just morbidly curious, but also scared to ask anything or anyone. And I wasn't making like many connections here, by the way. So this is me and Nurse Bob. There's a big room kind of like this. And there was like the main room where the kids hung out when they weren't being therapized or poked or prodded or anything like that. There's a pool table over here, a TV. In the middle of the room, kind of where the little paper towel machine is, was a janitor's closet. And I know it was a janitor's closet because it had a sign on it that said janitor's closet. And by the way, I just noticed, I go live and then I purposely take myself out of the frame, like in the computer. So the person's just staring and I'm just over here. And kind of funny. So what I noticed was during lunch, and our lunch went in two shifts. One was from 11:30 to 12, next one was from 12 to 12:30. And every single day that Bob was there, at 11:30, he would stop whatever he's doing, and he would go into the janitor's closet very quietly and unassumingly, and he would shut the door. And he wouldn't reemerge until 11:55, just before his lunch shift was over. That's what the way you're looking is kind of exactly. Once I picked up on this, and I'm like, I don't know, I'm just an intern. Like, these people have all worked here for a while. Like, it just kind of freaked me out a little bit. And I noticed some of the kids on the unit would even notice, like, oh, there goes Nurse Bob. So weeks go by, maybe 6 or 8 weeks or so. And I can't take it anymore. Like, I gotta know. And it's always locked, by the way. So it's not like you could get in there. I'd always like try to like, what the hell? So finally, after a little over a month or two, I got up the courage at lunch one day, before lunch started, to ask Bob. Like, and so I went up to him. Like, he knew exactly what I was going to say because it was close to lunch. And I'm like, Bob, I just can't easily just let me stop. I know what you're going to ask. I'm like, you do? And he's like, you want to know what I'm doing in the janitor's closet every day, don't you? I'm like, yep, I do. And he's like, well, I don't want to tell you. Let me show you. So he grabs me by the hand and starts taking me to the closet. And I'm like, oh shit, like I was thinking, like, maybe this was a bad idea. And I'll tell you what was in the closet next week, but we'll get there. So. That's why I said part one. Damn it! No, it's like a cliffhanger. See, it's tension in our lives that propels us, right, to move on to the next thing and bring us back. So. Now you got a reason to come back next Tuesday, or even just ask Macy, because she knows the rest of the story. I think she's the only one. But you know the rest of the story, don't you? No? Why am I placing you in that class? I don't know. All right, well, that's Nurse Bob. We'll come back to him next week. Unless somehow we end up like a half hour ahead of Team A, which is possible. You guys are good. No offense, Team A. Again, some of you have heard this name before. I think Macy, you know, same class. But if you haven't been in a class where I've told this story before, just play dumb. So for those of you who have never heard me talk about this guy before, does anyone know who Jason Becker is? Does this name light up any neurons in your brain at all? No. Okay. This always happens. No one ever knows. In fact, in the history of me talking about him, not one student, well, one student great, thought they were right, but they were wrong. Well, let me see if I can help you out. Does that help at all? Still no neurons firing. I mean, obviously, maybe you're guessing. Oh, yeah, the guitarist. No, don't cheat. All right, so what if I said the word Van Halen? Does that ring a bell? The name sound, most of you are saying, Dominic's like, I have no idea. When you hear the word, so something's lighting up in your brain. It has nothing to do with liking the music, but what does Van Halen mean to you? What is that? That's actually perfect because it's 2021 now, and Van Halen was a band that was really uber popular in the 80s. They were a gigantic rock band, still famous. In fact, one of their leaders, Eddie Van Halen, who was known as one of the world's greatest guitarists, just passed away from cancer about 2 months ago or so, something like that. So in other words, for most of you, I said Van Halen, and at least it triggered something. Like, I know the name. I'm not even sure why. Well, here's the sad truth. Well, first of all, Jason Becker is still alive. That's the good news. But if what happened to him did not happen to him, the same neurons that lit up when I said Van Halen would have lit up with the name Jason Becker. In other words, you might not know why you know the name, but 90% of the population would hear, oh yeah, Jason Becker. Oh, Jason, you would know it. It would sound familiar because he would have just been that big and that popular. But this is what happened to Jason. Awkward transition.
L-A-D, ladies, A-M-G-E, gentlemen, T-H-I, this is Jason Becker, T-H-E, the S-E-X, sexiest, M-A, man, alive. There's nobody better than that dude. He was on another level. When people would hear him, they'd turn their head and go, what the heck was that? But he wouldn't just play a Bach piece. He could set a guitar on his lap and play it that way. Jason was on his way to becoming a really big rock star. He was gonna just take over the world. And that's when Jason told us his leg was kind of bothering him.
He just had been limping for a while, and we finally talked him into getting it checked out at Kaiser in L.A. when he was there, and that's when all the trouble started.
We believe you've got Garrick's disease, and you have 3 to 5 years to live. I think his answer was, am I going to be able to tour? Mm-hmm. Eventually, he crutches in a wheelchair, and it just got to where, you know, he dropped the guitar, he couldn't hang on to it. When he was really sick, he was really thin and really pale. He was a different person. It never surprised me that if there was a way to keep hanging in, that he would.
His mind frame was, well, you know, I just didn't move. I just have to go do it. And so we created a system to allow Jason to be able, using just his chin, through one click of time, to be able to enter in the notes.
And he just kept working. Happened so young and he just still had a life to live and he wanted to live it. That's when I invented the sign language form. Basically, it's an eye geometry. Every letter of the alphabet has two eye movements.
I remember I came to his house and he played this thing and I went, how'd you do this? I was just four.
Why he's still here. But he's still here.
So people did donate, and they made it happen. A little bit more context here. And that's Jason today. So the big thing that had happened for him, David Lee Roth, used to be the lead singer of Van Halen, actually. David Lee Roth had his own band, and this is a little bit of rock nerd history for you, but David Lee Roth's guitarist was a guy by the name of Steve Vai. Does that ring a bell to anybody? Steve Vai is still alive. He's considered probably the world's best living guitarist, and not just in a rock sense, like you can play rock songs, but classical rock, anything. So that's who Steve Vai is. And Steve Vai got his start with David Lee Roth, and then Steve Vai was becoming so huge that he decided to leave. So the big deal in the rock world was, who the hell is going to replace Steve Vai, the world's greatest guitarist? Who's going to fill his shoes? So there was this search, and people started to float this name around. Hey, have you heard this Jason Becker kid? He's incredible. And he was known in the guitar community as the next, like, just huge thing. He could do anything. He was a prodigy since age 3 on the guitar. And his dream came true, 19 years old, and David Lee Roth signed him. And it was 3 days after signing that contract that he got the diagnosis. And he was supposed to tour with the band, had a new album coming out, it was going to be huge. He actually finished the album. He struggled at the very end because it was starting to affect his fingers, and David Lee Roth even noticed he was slowing down, but they let him finish the album, but he was never actually able to go on the tour, which was, of course, his lifelong dream. So I don't know what your lifelong dream is, but imagine being 19 years old, and I'm not sure how familiar you are with ALS or Lou Gehrig's disease, but I mean, first of all, it's a horrendous diagnosis, obviously, but to be diagnosed at 19, that's almost unheard of. The average age of diagnosis is somewhere in the 50s, so being stricken with this at 19 is just absurdly cruel. Not to mention, hey, by the way, congratulations, you achieved your dream. Now here's a disease that's literally going to rip this away from you within 6 months, and you probably only got 3 more years to live, by the way. Wow. So, I mean, it's a lot to swallow. And by the way, if you like documentaries, it's out there. It's called Not Dead Yet. They changed the name. So Not Dead Yet. It's not dead yet. He's still out there. Really good. It's out. You can find it in a lot of different places. But the end of the story, after a lot of different twists and turns, and this wouldn't be in the movie because this just happened. Jason Becker just finished his last album last year. It took him 3.5 years to write, and he wrote it entirely with his eyeballs. It's the only thing that he can move. That's it. He's himself, and he can move his eyes, and he uses that little, I don't know what to call it, that little diagram that his dad helped, and he has friends that put the notes where he tells to put them and how to write all this stuff. Got nominated for a Grammy Award. And what his friends with Steve Vai and the people he writes the music, they come over and they play the music, and that's how his albums are produced. I know you can't put yourself in those shoes because it's an impossible scenario and hypotheticals are weird anyway, But how many of you think you would have like the wherewithal to keep going? Or would you just want to be like, fuck it, I'm out? Like, now there's a plug that you could just unplug and say, I'm done. Would you unplug it or would you keep, you would unplug it?
That would be easy.
So what's different about it? I mean, his mom even said at the end, no one really knows why he's still here. He's now outlived Stephen Hawking, by the way. He's now the longest living person with ALS. Stephen Hawking was the longest living. He's now the longest survivor since diagnosis with ALS. And as far as you can tell, he's still in good health. I mean, relatively speaking. Yeah.
I feel like I was bored as well. I mean, I feel like it'd be so hard to see yourself go through that, especially with him. He's just like,
yeah, I know. And he's so young. Yeah. I know. Yeah.
I think for me, it's more of a, like, being able to exist and watch everything, I'm okay with that. It's just I would miss doing stuff.
Yeah.
Like, even just as much as I don't like doing laundry, like, I miss being able to fold my own laundry. Or I want to walk outside if I want to.
Everything, right? It's funny. I actually would highly recommend the documentary. This isn't like, I'm not just saying this flippantly. Every once in a while, when I'm going through something like ridiculously hard, I often think of him. You can become his Facebook friend and he'll take your request. It's not like it's special that I'm his Facebook friend, but I follow him. He's a really inspiring guy. And I'm not lying. Every time something's like hard or like 2 days ago, I burnt my hand really bad with turkey broth. It's a long story, but anyway. I'm not lying. It actually crossed my mind. I'm like, well, it could be worse. Like, these things always come into my mind when I think of this. Like, I'm not going to, nope, not going to complain about that. But so, long story short, it's not like this happened to him and he stayed, like, positive and cheery and happy the entire time. He went through, maybe you could tell just by seeing that, he looks very different now than he did maybe a year or so after his diagnosis. He went through a long journey and a long period where he was pondering suicide and just ending it, and maybe this is just let me die. In fact, the darkest day for him, he said, was the day he got his, what's it called? The trachea tube put in. He remembers it like vividly because he knew that would be the end of a lot of things. Like, he fought to keep breathing on his own for as long as he could. But he somehow found his way back. So it's not like he instantly just started writing music with his eyeballs. It took years for him to come back to a place where he felt, I guess we'd use the word satisfied. And he is. In terms of, and this isn't a lie, he wouldn't be able to do what he's doing if this wasn't true. If we compared his, let's say, life satisfaction, another how satisfied he is with his life, he would be equivalent to all of you in this room. Maybe a little bit of a difference here and there. And some people think that can't possibly be true. But the answer to how that's possible is the world of positive psychology. And that's where we're starting here. So let me see. Where does this start? Okay, so positive psych. What in the heck is this? So think of the world of psychology, and hopefully you've been around the psych department long enough to kind of get this intuitively. If the world of psychology is a pie, there's lots of different pieces. There's abnormal psych, which is the world of mental illness. There's cognitive psych, which is cognitive psych. There's the psychology of humor. Well, positive psychology is, I guess, the newest piece of the pie. And it's gone through a long journey to earn respect because when it first came to, it's actually been around for centuries, the idea. But just like humor, and I guess that's why I like comparing it with this, just like humor, it's taken a while to garner, I guess, respect in the field, but it's there now. It's pretty well established. So let's start with the one thing that it isn't. I know this is out of order, but the one thing positive psychology is not, you're going to hear someone else use this word. It's not happyology. Not say what I mean by that. Happiness is an emotion. We all like to feel it. No one would question that. We all like to feel happy. But positive psychology is not the study of why people are happy or how to make you more happy. or how to get you to express more happiness. That's not what it is. Because believe it or not, how quote unquote happy you feel has actually very little to do with your life satisfaction. Well, you'll get there before you leave. If that doesn't make any sense, it will make sense, I think, within the next 45 minutes or so. So it's not happyology. It's not about creating these emotions. I'm sure you've all seen an ad somewhere on a billboard. We used to say newspaper, but I don't know if you pick those up anymore. But if you did, pick up any newspaper in any city, somewhere in there you'd probably find some kind of ad that says something like the following. Are you between the ages of 18 and 35? Have you been diagnosed with breast cancer? Do you smoke? Are you sick? We'd come into our lab, we'll pay you $50. We'd like to study you. Right? You've seen these. Like, we want to, if there's something wrong with you, we want to bring you in the lab so we can dissect you and find out what that is so we can get rid of it. Now, how often do you see an ad that says, are you between the ages of 18 and 35? Are you extremely happy? Are you satisfied with your life? Is there nothing wrong with you? Is your life as excellent as it possibly could be? Well, come into our lab because we'd like to study you. No, you never see that. And that's kind of the point. A bunch of people in the field of psychology started asking the question. I mean, it's not that we studying what's wrong isn't good. Of course, we need to do that. We need to keep doing that so we can fix the things that are bad. But why don't we ever spend time studying exceptional people and strengths and see if we can learn from that? So one thing, there's two things that positive psychology is. One is it's the study of human potential and human strength. Why are some people just exceptional in their field? What makes them tick? What in the hell, why is Jason Becker so different than all the people in the world that would pull the plug? Even though he came to the brink. Okay, why? What makes him different? So it's the study of people's strengths instead of deficits. And the second thing it is it's a way to apply this. So the applying of principles to take people from being normal and average to being above average and exceptional. Let me make you an analogy of what we mean by that. When people come into therapy, if they're depressed or anxious or fill in the blank, what the client always says, 100% of the time, they just want to be normal. I just want to get rid of this so I can feel normal, right? It's like when you're sick. If you're sick, you just want that to go away so you can just be normal again. Oh, I just want to be normal. Well, positive psychology would say, what? Why do we stop there? What's so good about being normal and average? I mean, I get it. Relatively speaking, if you're down here, being normal is a good thing. But what if we can take normal people and put them up here and make them even better than normal? Is there a science to this that we can learn? And the world of positive psychology says there absolutely is. You don't need to write this down, but just in case you didn't know, there's actually ways, therapeutic methods and techniques to literally, within a fairly short amount of time, improve the quality of your life and make you more satisfied, make you more engaged, make you more social, whatever it is. And we've learned that from the field of positive psychology. So that's a little bit of an introduction from me. Just jot this down for now. This will make it, if you've never heard about this before, this will sound like a foreign language. And I'm going to let a guy named Martin start talking. If there's a main theme to positive psychology, it's about improving people's well-being and life satisfaction. And to understand how you get there, you first have to understand that people's conception of life satisfaction and life well-being exists in three different domains in our life, what positive psychology calls the three lives that you lead. If happiness and life, put it this way, if life satisfaction is the goal, there are three roots that feed it. Maybe that's a better way to put it. So here's life satisfaction. There's three things that feed this thing, and we want it to get bigger. So what are these three different lives that we lead that are connected to our life satisfaction? Does that make sense? It's a weird way of talking about it. I like that analogy. So if life satisfaction is like a bucket we want to fill, there's three hoses going into it. The problem with a lot of us, I'm not trying to put you in this box, but you might be in that box, a lot of people place way too much emphasis on the wrong hose. They think that's the important one, and they kind of neglect the other two. When the reality is, the other two are actually vastly more important than the other one. But they all play some type of role. It's just the emphasis is a little bit different. And let me start here just by asking a question before I flip over to this and let some other guy talk. I don't do this in every first year seminar, but I try to if I can remember it. When we ask freshmen, and this isn't just a Mount Union thing, this is actually sort of a national thing. So people that teach classes with freshmen are kind of keen to this stuff. When we ask freshmen, why are you here? A lot of them inevitably say, well, you guys want to get a job, blah, blah, blah. And then we lead down the road of, what do you think will make you satisfied in your life? Like, what's the end goal? Like, what do you need to do this? Two answers rise to the top. What do you suppose those are? I mean, they say lots of things, but, and I had one semester where literally at work, I made them make a list, and for like 5 out of the 16 students, this was literally 1 and 2. I'm like, oh my God, it's true. I mean, it is true. But it was almost on everyone's list. So what do 18-year-olds coming to college, what are their goals? Because they want to be happy, right? We all want to be happy and satisfied, but what's going to get them there? Yeah. Kind of. They do, but what is get a good, what, how do they define good job? You're right. So you're actually not wrong. There you go. The good job is the one that makes them lots of money. So they want to be rich. That one, which kind of makes me laugh. Which I guess is some maybe kind of connected, number one. They want to be famous. So freshmen coming to college, they want to be rich someday and they want to be famous. And when we talk about like fame, like what do you mean? It's a weird, they don't talk about fame in a way like, well, I want to be famous because I want to do so well in my field that I become like a distinguished, you know, like, no, the fame they're thinking about is they want to make the viral YouTube video that makes them an instant millionaire. And that's it. So they can be done. So they want to be this like internet famous for doing nothing like the Kardashians. They just want to kind of fall into stuff. And like, oh, you're famous. You're rich for not really accomplishing anything. Those are our 18-year-old life goals. But they're not for like bad reasons. The reasons they think, and a lot of people think this way, is that that is what's blocking them from being completely satisfied or more happy with their life. And then maybe they learn something like this. So Martin Seligman, this is kind of an older video, so it's not in HD or anything like that. In fact, it's from a conference on positive psychology. Martin Seligman isn't some kind of quack coming out of left field. He actually used to be the president of the APA, the American Psychiatric Association. So he's not like a nobody. He was once the president of psychology, essentially. So if he's talking about it, it must mean something. It takes a little bit of time, but he eventually starts to make sense. And then we'll pause it and kind of fill in some blanks.
So they came to me, CNN, and they said, Professor Seligman, would you tell us about the state of psychology today? We'd like to hear you about that. And I said, great. He said, but this is CNN, so you only get a sound bite. But well, how many words do I get? I said, well, one. The cameras rolled, and she said, Professor Seligman, what is the state of psychology today? Good. Cut. That won't do. We really better give you a longer sound bite. Well, how many words do I get this time? I think we'll get 2. Dr. Seligman, what is the state of psychology today? Not good. Look, Dr. Sully, you can see you're really not comfortable in this medium. We better give you a real sound bite this time. You can have three words. Professor Seligman, what is the state of psychology today? Not good enough. And that's what I'm going to be talking about. I want to say why psychology was good, why it was not good, and how it may become in the next 10 years good enough. And by parallel summary, I want to say the same thing about technology, about entertainment and design, because I think the issue is very similar. So why was psychology good? Well, for more than 60 years, psychology worked within the disease model. 10 years ago, when I was on an airplane, I introduced myself to my seatmate and told them what I did. They moved away from me. And because quite rightly, they were saying psychology is about finding what's wrong with you. Spot the loony. And now when I tell people what I do, they move toward me. And what was good psychology, about the $30 billion investment NIMH made, about working in the disease model, about what you mean by psychology, is that 60 years ago, none of the disorders were treatable. It was entirely smoke and mirrors. And now 14 of the disorders are treatable, two of them actually curable. And the other thing that happened is that a science developed, a science of mental illness, that we found out that we could take fuzzy concepts like depression, alcoholism, and measure them with rigor, that we could create a classification of the mental illnesses, that we could understand the causality of mental illnesses. We could look across time at the same people, people, for example, who are genetically vulnerable to schizophrenia, and ask what the contribution of mothering of genetics are, and we could isolate third variables by doing experiments on mental illnesses. And best of all, we were able in the last 50 years to invent drug treatments and psychological treatments, and then we were able to test them rigorously in random assignment, placebo-controlled designs, throw out the things that didn't work, keep the things that actively did. And the conclusion of that is that psychology and psychiatry over the last 60 years can actually claim that we can make miserable people less miserable. And I think that's terrific, and I'm proud of it. But what was not good, the consequences of that, were three things. The first was moral, that psychologists and psychiatrists became victimologists, pathologizers, that our view of human nature was that if you were in trouble, bricks fell on you. And we forgot that people made choices and decisions. We forgot responsibility. That was the first cause. The second cause was that we forgot about you people. We forgot about improving normal lives. We forgot about a mission to make relatively untroubled people happier, more fulfilled, more productive. And genius, high talent, became a dirty word. No one works on that. And the third problem about the disease model is in our rush to do something about people in trouble, in our rush to do something about repairing damage, it never occurred to us to develop interventions to make people happier, positive interventions. So that was not good. And so that's what led the people like Nancy Etkoff, Dan Gilbert, Mike Csikszentmihalyi, and myself to work in something I call positive psychology, which has three aims. The first is that psychology should be just as concerned with human strength as it is with weakness. It should be just as concerned with building strength as with repairing damage. It should be interested in the best things in life, and it should be just as concerned with making the lives of normal people fulfilling, and with genius, with nurturing high talent. So in the last 10 years, and the hope for the future, we've seen the beginnings of a science of positive psychology, a science of what makes life worth living. It turns out that we can measure different forms of happiness, and any of you for free can go to that website and take the entire panoply of tests of happiness. You can ask, how do you stack up for positive emotion, for meaning, for flow, against literally tens of thousands of other people? We created the opposite of the diagnostic manual of the insanities, a classification of the strengths and virtues that looks at the sex ratio, how they're defined, how to diagnose them, what builds them and what gets in their way. We found that we could discover the causation of the positive states, the relationship between left hemispheric activity and right hemispheric activity as a cause of happiness. I spent my life working on extremely miserable people, and I've asked the question, how do extremely miserable people differ from the rest of you? And so I know 6 years ago, we asked about extremely happy people and how they differ from the rest of us. And it turns out there's one way, very surprising, they're not more religious, they're not in better shape, they don't have more money, they're not better looking, they don't have more good events and fewer bad events. But one way in which they differ, they're extremely social. They don't sit in seminars on Saturday morning. They don't spend time alone. Each of them is in a romantic relationship, and each has a rich repertoire of friends. But watch out here. This is merely correlational data, not causal. And it's about happiness in the first Hollywood sense I'm going to talk about. Happiness of ebullience and giggling and good cheer. And I'm going to suggest to you that's not nearly enough in just a moment. We found we could begin to look at interventions over the centuries, from the Buddha to Tony Robbins. About 120 interventions have been proposed that allegedly make people happy. And we find that we've been able to manualize many of them, and we actually carry out random assignment efficacy and effectiveness studies. That's which ones actually make people lastingly happier. In a couple of minutes, I'll tell you about some of those results. But the upshot of this is that the mission I want psychology to have, in addition to its mission of curing the mentally ill, in addition to its mission of making miserable people less miserable, is can psychology actually make people happier? And to ask that question, happy is not a word I use very much. We've had to break it down into what I think is askable about happy. And I believe there are three different, and I call them different because different interventions build them. It's possible to have one rather than the other. Three different happy lives. The first happy life is the pleasant life. This is a life in which you have as much positive emotion as you possibly can and the skills to amplify it. The second is a life of engagement, a life in your work, your parenting, your love, your leisure. Time stops for you. That's what Aristotle was talking about. And third, the meaningful life. So I want to say a little bit about each of those lives and what we know about them. The first life is the pleasant life. And it's simply, as best we can find it, it's having as many of the pleasures as you can, as much positive emotion as you can, and learning the skills, savoring mindfulness that amplify them.
I'm going to stop here. You're not done talking about it yet, but here's what I want you to know about the pleasant life. So a couple things. So the first, I wish I would have thought of that analogy on Tuesday, because some people left still sound pretty happy. And I wish he even said it. He doesn't mean happy in the sense that we all think happy, so he doesn't use that word very often. But the pleasant life is the experience of happiness itself, pleasurable emotion. And there's one thing to add to that, it's the pleasurable emotion associated with some kind of stimulus in the environment. In other words, material things, money, fame. That new shirt at Kohl's, the 30% off. In fact, I like using that as an example. So the pleasant life is experiencing as much pleasurable emotion as possible from the things that you can collect, material possessions. That's the pleasant life. fact, I didn't do this on Tuesday, but this actually makes a little bit more sense. You guys always reap the benefits of me doing the review. So, Mike, what's your goal? This is that question that we ask, well, just a lot of people in general. You asked 100 people, what would make you happier? I'm sure a lot of people would say more money. So let's add a little bit to this before you go any further. There's a catch to this. This, the pleasant life, is what most people place the most importance on in our culture because they think this is it, at least the most important one. This is the root. This is the pursuit of happiness, the pleasant life for most people. And this is why people say things like, well, I want to be rich and famous. I want to get a good job. Okay, what's a good job? Well, the one that pays me the most. That'll make me happy. The problem with this, though, is that's a fallacy. And it's hard to not believe this if you believe it. I totally get it. But you'll understand it eventually. When it comes to, so the important thing, other than experiencing happiness, because we can all experience happiness, the goal for life is to be satisfied. You want to be, if you can just, you want to be satisfied with high level of satisfaction with your life. That's the goal. Everyone wants to be highly satisfied. That means you're content. Yes, I'm very happy with my life. I'm satisfied. So well-being and life satisfaction is the goal. People think this is what gets them there. The problem is, if I know everything about this, about you, all your money, your income, your material possessions, whatever it is, that only accounts for 10% of your life satisfaction. So only 10% of your life satisfaction and overall well-being comes from this. And it's that low. A lot of people think that's astoundingly low, but just wait till the next one. Maybe some light bulbs will go off. Like, oh, so it turns out that's more important. The reason, well, there's two reasons why this is that way. And the first is something you've all experienced and you'll continue to experience, and that's what we call hedonic habituation. Not sure if you noticed, but my shirt is quite wrinkled. And I'm not pointing that out for some kind of like vain reason. I don't care that it's wrinkled. Some days my 9-year-old likes to pick out my clothes and I just let her do it. She's like, she wants to be like a fashion person. So she loves, so she's really, she, ever since she was 3, actually using Kohl's, and I remember taking her to Kohl's. She used to go up to the mannequins and she would rearrange them. And she'd step back like, that's better. The worker's like, what did she just do? Like she has her own design. So, anyway, it's just something she likes to do. She likes to pick out shirts for daddy. So she came in the room this morning and said, you can't wear that one. It's purple. Like, yeah, well, honey, it's so wrinkled. She's like, that doesn't matter. I'm like, what? It's like, it's all wrinkled. And she's like, it's a new fashion, daddy. Just say it's your new fashion. It's like, it's a design. She liked the design that I made. Fine, it was weird. So she's happy. I don't care. But anyway, the reason I'm telling you this is it has nothing to do with that. There was a day, in fact, last year, when this was my new shirt, and it was my new shirt from Kohl's, and I got it for 30% off, and I saved $3,000. That, you know, if you've been to Kohl's, they tell you that you've saved $5,672 today. Oh, by the way, here's $10 in Kohl's cash, so you'll come right back 2 weeks from now. But anyway, so I'm also in the vicious cycle. But there was a day when this was the new shirt. Have you ever had a new shirt? You love it, right? What happens when you put on a new shirt? Hey, what's going on? No, it changes, right? It changes the dress for success. Why do we say that? Because it makes you feel, right? There is. There's something that happens. It boosts your confidence. You just feel different. And it's fantastic because it's new shirt. But how long does it take before a new shirt gets overtaken and it starts to fall back, you know, back to the back of the closet, and there's other new shirts that come in, and new shirt's like, are you cheating on me? No, I swear to God, you're still new shirt. But anyway, you get the idea, right? Hedonic habituation, it loses its appeal, and we need to replace it. That's why people
Like they have, I have the iPhone 16R, but I need the iPhone 16RS. Like that's why they have to have it, because this was, your phone was awesome 6 months ago. It was awesome, but now it sucks. Why does it suck? It still does the same thing, but you need the new button that's on there. You need the different size because of hedonic habituation. And hedonic habituation, by the way, I'm not putting a value judgment on it. It's not good or bad. It's just a thing. It just happens, and this is how capitalism works. It relies on this. What do you mean you've had your car for 3 years? That's too old. You need a new car. The hedonic habituation, it wears off. The point behind this is, you got $100,000 a year, guess what you want? $200,000. You get $200,000, guess what you want? $400,000. This is why the Indians will never keep a good plan. Because, one more, hedonic habituation. The other reason, though, this is not true, is because of the impact bias. And the impact bias is why a lot of people don't understand Jason Becker's situation. There was a study done once on lottery winners and recent paraplegics. And obviously, two very different life experiences. Maybe you've heard about this one before. And they were interested in life satisfaction and well-being over the long haul, not over the short haul. And so, I don't remember what the amount. There was a certain ceiling these lottery winners had to win to be part of the study. But they had like 50 or so in each group. They looked at the lottery winners and the recent paraplegics. And of course, the paraplegics showed a very distinct, these are people who got in car accidents. There was a huge drop in their life satisfaction and well-being. And of course, for the lottery winners, it went the opposite way. But they kept watching these people over time. And what slowly started to happen was the two lines started to intersect. And in the long term, you could barely tell the difference between the two groups of individuals. And that's because of the impact bias, and this is what it is. It's all about overestimating. We overestimate the long-term impact of both positive and negative events. We think that a strong negative event is going to change our life forever. This is why post that breakup, you think the sun is never going to come up again. But over time, our well-being has a way of restoring itself. What positive psychology is about the techniques and interventions to help get you there. But the flip side is also true. We also overestimate these positive events. So we go after something and we always think that happiness is on the other side of the goal. Well, once I graduate, then I'll be happy. Once I find a job, then I'll be happy. Once I get this raise, then I'll be happy. Well, what about ways to make yourself just happier now? That's what positive psychology is all about. Not putting happiness on the other side of a goal. Because if that's true, you're just going to keep moving the goalpost. It's going to keep going and going perpetually, forever. What about just making yourself satisfied right now and getting rid of this drive to keep? Not that driving after goals isn't important. That's important. But if happiness, though, is that, there's other things that you can do. So that's the pleasant life. So for each of these, we'll kind of pause and get into them a little bit more.
That's stretching over time and space. But the pleasant life has three drawbacks, and it's why positive psychology is not happyology, and why it doesn't end here. The first drawback is that it turns out the pleasant life, your experience of positive emotion, is heritable, like 50% heritable, and in fact, not very modifiable. So the different trips that Mathieu and I and others know about increasing the amount of positive emotion in your life are 15 to 20% trips, getting more of it. Second is that the positive emotion habituates. It habituates rapidly, indeed. It's all like French vanilla ice cream. The first taste is 100%. By the time you're down to the sixth taste, it's gone. And as I said, it's not particularly malleable. And this leads to the second life. I'd say by my friend Len to talk about why positive psychology is more than positive emotion, more than building pleasure. In two of the three great arenas of life, by the time Len was 30, Len was enormously successful. The first arena was work. By the time he was 20, he's an options trader. By the time he was 25, he's a multimillionaire and has an options trading company. Second in play is a national champion bridge player. And but in the third great arena of life, love, Len is an abysmal failure. And the reason he was that Len is a cold fish. Len is an introvert. American women said to Len when he dated them, "You're no fun. You don't have positive emotion. Get lost." And Len was wealthy enough to be able to afford a Park Avenue psychoanalyst who for 5 years tried to find the sexual trauma that had somehow locked positive emotion inside him. But it turned out there wasn't any sexual trauma. It turned out that Len grew up in Long Island. He played football and watched football and played bridge. Len is in the bottom 5% of what we call positive affectivities. The question is Len unhappy? And I want to say no. Contrary to what psychology told us about the bottom 50% of the human race in positive affectivity, I think Len is one of the happiest people I know. He's not consigned to the hell of unhappiness. And that's because Len, like most of you, is enormously capable of flow. When he walks onto the floor of the American Exchange at 9:30 in the morning, time stops for him. And it stops till the closing bell. When the first card is played, so 10 days later, the tournament is over, time stops for Len. And this is indeed what Mike Csikszentmihalyi has been talking about flow, and it's distinct from pleasure in a very important way. Pleasure has raw feels. You know it's happening. It's thought and feeling. But what Mike told you yesterday, during flow, you can't feel anything. You're one with the music. Time stops. You have intense concentration. And this is indeed characteristic of what we think of as the good life. And we think there's a recipe for it, and it's knowing what your highest strengths are. And again, there's a valid test of what your five highest strengths are, and then recrafting your life to use them as much as you possibly can. Recrafting your work, your love, your play, your friendship, your parenting. But
just to pause it there. So the second life is where the bulk, actually, of our life satisfaction and well-being exists. So we're doing a ratio of 10% of pleasant life, probably about 60% of good life. You can do the math for yourself. These aren't exact numbers, by the way. I don't like these percentages, by the way, because the important message is very little comes from the pleasant life, although we assume it does. Most of it comes here. The good life, and this sounds like a pop psychology term that you hear like on Dr. Phil, like where'd you pull that out of thin air? Or something like Deepak Chopra might say, which by the way, he actually has a lot of good things to say. But you hear people use words like this, and I think we don't really interpret them as serious words with definitions or a way to get there. But to distill the good life down, it's the pursuit of flow in both your work and your personal relationships. That's what it is. So what is flow? Well, let me give you a definition. Not the one from the desert. Right. So flow, again, I think this is the same way I worded this on Tuesday, so I'm trying to be careful with this. Flow is the unconscious experience of complete engagement in the present moment. You've all experienced it, at least I hope you all have. But it's the unconscious experience of total engagement in the present moment. That's why he said things like, you can't feel it. Time stands still. Time isn't important. You're not thinking about the past. You're not thinking about, worried about the future. You're just doing what it is you're doing for the sake of doing that thing. So it's the unconscious experience of total engagement in the present moment. People who excel at this, it doesn't mean they're walking around 24 hours a day. But no, it just means they have these experiences again and again. The best analogy I can give you that you might be able to relate to, if this still seems trippy and out there, I guess it depends on your experience with the dentist and how much you like being there. I think I used the dentist as an example a few weeks ago, but when I'm at the dentist, time crawls. Like every second is like just, I can't wait for it to be over. The whole time I'm there, I just want to leave. Like I can't wait for that moment in the parking lot. Like, all right, I'm all done. 6 more months. Don't have to worry. Right? The time I'm there, though, is like excruciating. Like, man, it's only been 20 minutes. It feels like it's been an hour because I'm like counting the seconds. And if you've ever done something like that, maybe you sat in a boring class. Damn it.
Is it 2:10 yet?
Have you ever sat in a class? You've just been like,
Jesus Christ.
Because you can't, right? That is the polar opposite of flow. You're thinking about something else. You're not in the moment at all. And you just wish you were not in the moment. For myself, this is why I like amusement parks so much. You know, most of you know I'm an amusement park complete nerd, total junkie. And I like them for a lot of reasons. But one of the main reasons I like them so much is because when you get there and you go through the gates, for those 8 hours or whatever it is, you're just there. There's boundaries around you. You're not really in the real world. I'm not worried about anything else. I'm just having fun. And time flies. I look down at the clock. I'm like, it's already freaking 3? God dang it. Like, why can't vacations feel like forever? And dentist visits feel like 5 minutes. Like, why can't it go that way? It's also, if someone brought this up on Tuesday, like, we ever, like, when you first get in like a relationship, where I'm like, oh my God, we talked till 3 a.m. We've been on the phone for this long. How did that happen? Oh my God. You say goodbye first. No, you say goodbye. No, you say goodnight. Right? But time flies because you're totally engaged in the moment. Bad dates are the opposite. You can't wait. You're trying crawling out of your skin, trying to find a way to get out of the situation. So that's flow. Total engagement, present moment, time stops. If you can't tell, maybe you can, maybe you can't, but that's kind of what happens here. Just long story short, because I don't have time for the whole story, I never planned on being a teacher at all. That was not in the works. I wanted to be a therapist, that's it. The only reason I got a PhD is because I was in grad school and I got asked to teach a class. I was like, what, teach a class? But I needed a job. Okay, I'll do it. And the little guy, his name was Al, he's like, hey, start tomorrow. I'm like, I had no time to prepare whatsoever. But I knew the subject I was going to teach. I'm like, okay, I'm like 24, teaching people that look just like me. This is a little bit awkward. I had no idea what to do. Within 20 minutes of teaching that class, a big light bulb went off. And I started having like an out-of-body experience. I was like, Kevin, this is what you're supposed to do. Because I was having so much fun. And I experienced it for the first time in my life doing a job. I experienced what they're talking about. Like, it was just like, yep, this is it. It doesn't mean every single day I come to work, every single minute I'm teaching is like magical class. But man, it's so much fun. I actually volunteer for my wife when she's, some of you, when my wife teaches here, when she's sick, I'm like, can I teach? Can I go teach your class? Like, what? I just want to, like, I'll go teach your class because I love it. I just like it. It's something I actually enjoy doing. So that's flow in your work. So how the hell do you get there? Because he mentioned this idea is like, we think we have a formula. It turns out there actually, this isn't all of it, but there actually is a formula built in to something you probably already either learned about or heard about. I'm not sure how in-depth you got into it. You know you're a nerd in psychology when you have a favorite theory of developmental psychology, and I have one. It's by a guy named Eric Erickson. Maybe you've heard of him. But his name is over here. So the one formula, this is just one way to think about achieving flow. Not the whole recipe, but this is one formula that's easy to use and apply for you. comes from a guy by the name of Eric Erickson. The reason I like him so much is he wrote this stuff and had these ideas 100 years ago. He was actually a student of Freud. That's how old this guy is. But the ideas, the themes of what he talked about, I guarantee you are still relevant to you today. It still makes sense. So you don't need to write all of this down. I'm saying this so you understand what we're about to talk about. His theory is a theory of how you develop emotionally as a person, from infancy all the way to death's door. And he takes you all the way from birth to death, which also I like about it. Now, how do human beings change as emotional beings from birth to death? That's a lot to cover. He argues, and that's why this is up there, his point was, there's 8, and again, we could argue all day about, well, maybe there's 10. In his view, there's 8 major emotional stages that a human being moves through in life. And each of these stages is some kind of big emotional crisis that you have to resolve as a human being. If it's a crisis, that means it could either go a good way or a bad way. Don't write this down, but in case you've never heard this before, let me give you an example. His first stage, easy. He's talking about infancy. What kind of emotional crisis could an infant possibly be going through? Well, if you ever spent time around them, they're clearly going through something. Erickson's idea, he called it trust versus mistrust. Trust versus, and the whole, his idea was, your first emotional crisis as a human being, you're either going to learn that you can trust the world around you to take care of you, and you can depend on others, and you're worthy of being taken care of, or you're going to learn that the world is very mistrustful. Sometimes you cry, and sometimes those people come, but sometimes they don't. Maybe they don't come at all. Does that make sense? So this resolution that you're either, I cry and they come and I can depend on others, or I cry and they don't come and I'm all on my own. Trust versus mistrust. So these crises, by the way, in these stages, he's not implying that they're the only thing that you have to go through, but they're the major theme that you're going through right now. I hope that makes sense. Enjoy. All right, so here's where I start to like it, and maybe you'll kind of get the idea. And this is why I would argue it's still very relevant for you today, even though it's 2021. A lot of these 8 stages, you guys are in what's called identity versus confusion. That's why that's up there. Some of you actually may be beyond it. I don't know your personal life story. But age-wise, young adulthood, late adolescence, whatever you want to call yourself, it's identity versus confusion. I certainly spent a lot of time in this with regard to my work. And in fact, that's why I told you that story. It wasn't until that light bulb moment when I finally had it figured out. Identity versus confusion means exactly what it sounds like. You're trying to find your purpose, who you are as a person, and what you want to do with your life. That's what identity is. Who you are as a person, that means all sorts of things like virtues, beliefs. Can you stand on your own and say, yes, I believe in this? That takes time. But also, what would you like to do with your life? Why do people come to college? Well, most people come to a college because they want to figure out what it is they want to do with their life. Or they have an idea, only to change their mind later on. But that's right. Lots of students come to college and universities because they would like to figure out. This is why you take assessments, like career assessments, of like, I don't know what to do with that. So that's why I still like this. And maybe I like it because it resonated for me. When I was at Ohio State as an undergrad, sorry, the Ohio State University, I changed my undergrad major 6 times. And that's not an exaggeration. One of them was not officially declared, but it was an idea. 6 freaking times. I'll just lay that little seed for you. We'll come back to it later. I don't recommend the path that I took at all. I was just very, very, very confused. And I desperately didn't want to be confused. So I kept trying things. So it turns out, here's the recipe. So if you want to find flow, and as we talk about these, I want you to think about both work, career, but also relationships. Because when we're talking about flow, is what we're talking about. And these apply to both perfectly. There's 2 dimensions, 2 things, 2 activities that go into achieving flow in your life, and that's exploration and also commitment. It's a little bit more complex than this, but because this isn't developmental psychology, I just want to kind of get it so you get the idea here. So exploration and commitment. If you're a math whiz, you realize since there's two factors, there's four different possible outcomes. Because we're on a scale of high to low on both of these, we got four different outputs that we can have, and that's what's over there. There's four different identity styles, only one of which will experience flow in their life. And as I explain them, you'll probably, context clues, you'll figure out exactly where they rank. I like telling stories about my old roommates, and I always tell stories about my old roommates here. I had a roommate named Jim, one of many roommates. Jim definitely qualified at the time, he's different now, but he qualified at the time for what we'd call a diffuse identity style. Jim was an extraordinarily good student in high school and actually very bright in college. All A's as far as I know. He had a full ride, computer engineering, but he had no interest really in being there. He wore robes a lot and kind of sat in his room and smoked a lot of weed and played a lot of video games. He went to his classes when he had to, and he was smart enough to get by doing that, but he never really picked a major, ever. In fact, you can't do this here at Mount Union, but he graduated from Ohio State with a general education degree, which means he literally graduated undecided. I mean, like, I don't know if you can still do that, but yeah. Right, he graduated, me too, believe me. I look back and I'm like, because I was the most undecided person that I knew. So he's definitely diffused. We'll come back to Jim in a second. So again, he kind of looked like North American Jesus, like he wore really long hair. Actually, he wore a brown robe a lot. So I used to cut his hair for him sometimes. But anyway, that's Jim. So he's in his room smoking pot. We'll actually come back to him. We're going to knock on his door about 5 minutes. For the next one, let me give you a hypothetical. And for some of you, I think you've heard this story before, especially if you're my freshman, we can talk about this. Think back to, just want to give you an idea of how people find themselves in these situations. Picture yourself a month before coming to Mount Union. So wherever you were, not sure where you're from, but it's a month before you're about to start the year. Exceptional starts there, I can't wait. But you're sitting on your bed in your room, and you hear a knock at the door.
Well, Brady. Brady, honey.
Yes, Mom.
Brady.
Open the door, Mom.
Okay.
And your mom and then your dad come in the room, and you're sitting there, and you're excited. You're trying on your purple jacket. You can't wait. And you notice your dad has a little piece of paper in his hand. And they sit down on the bed next to you. Brady, we have an offer to make you, Brady. You're like, okay, Dad. And mind you, your dad, maybe he's not Brady, but your dad is an accountant. He's a very wealthy accountant. So he has lots of means. And here's the deal. You go to Mount Union. If you major in business and specialize in accounting and never get below a C-, we will pay for everything. Room board. When I say everything, I mean everything. So any quarter that you put into a laundry machine, that's going to come right back to you. Any dollar you spend on food is going to come right back to you. Just show your dad the receipt, reimbursed for everything. How many of you have like a little job, like even a tiny crappy job? Yeah, exactly. Imagine how much money you could save, though, even at a bad job, if you never had to pay a bill. Like literally, you spend all your time just collecting money. You're just giving more because I don't have to pay for it. That's the deal. Here's the other twist, though. If you ever renege on it and decide you want to change your major, you're on your own. You're cut loose. How many of you would take the deal? Now, I always preface this by saying, if your dream is to be an accountant, then
hooray! Oh, my God, Father, I love you! Thank you so much! Oh.
And now you know how accountants sound in my cartoon. Sorry, anyone.
Damn it! I knew I talked that way.
And know anyone notice? Is your dad an accountant? Oh, look, that's awesome. But you wouldn't. You clearly wouldn't take the deal.
Oh, see, my dad, like, Yeah, have you ever majored in accounting or anything?
Oh, wow, he was the opposite.
Yeah.
That's funny. Would anyone take the deal? Like, let's say, even if you had no, let's say you didn't know what you wanted to major in, would you take it? Why not? Everything, come on, folks. Everything's paid for. Student debt sucks.
I'd rather be in debt than be sad.
Okay, well, true story. This is actually a very true story. And it's my roommate, Jeff. One of my roommates, Jeff. And we discovered this little contract about 2 weeks into college. You can maybe play in your mind of how this played out. It was about 1 in the morning. And we were just doing our thing at 1 in the morning. And we were kind of in Jeff's room. And I was the one, Jake, another roommate, noticed at first. He's like, guys, look at this. And I went over and I'm like, what in the hell? And it was taped kind of by his bed. It was the contract. And it was essentially this, all typed out, like in legalese, and his dad had signed it, his mom had signed it, and Jeff had signed it. He had taken, and he came in, he said, oh my God, like, you don't want to find it, why the hell did you tape it on your wall by your bed? Like, what? Like, there it is, everyone. So he told us this story, and I'm like, but I guess it sounds okay if that's what you want to do. But the problem is, Jeff hated his classes. He hated them. In fact, slowly over the years, he was fun on weekends, but he sucked on weekdays because you've had classes you hate. Like, what I don't mean is like bored, but like you just, I can't. I just know. He hated business. And he didn't like accounting, but he kept going. And we spent a long time like trying to get him to like, but how do you do that? Like, it's his choice. Like, but we're like, you're not going to be happy. And I tell students all the time, if you don't like your classes, you're going to hate your job. Because your job is, like, your classes, the only now out there. What did that one video say? You're going to spend 90,000 hours, like, in your job? Remember that? Something like that? Hey, you spent a lot of time there. So, anyway, Jeff, he graduated business, became an accountant. To this day, he's the only person I've ever met in my life who graduated as an undergrad and bought a house. Like, literally bought a house and a new car. He had lots of money. He had lots of things. He had the pleasant life, like, whoa, we'll come back to him a little bit too. But he was miserable. In fact, we were kind of worried about him for a long time, actually, because he was seriously depressed. I don't mean that in a flippant sense. Like, he was major depressed. Like, I was worried, borderline suicidal depressed, and very lonely. Just, I don't know. He wasn't the Jeff that I met on day one on the campus. The third one is something called moratorium. You're probably putting the pieces together here. Here's where I spent a god-awful amount of time. Moratorium is when you're exploring. Oh, by the way, I'm sorry. Foreclose is when you've committed with no exploration. Sorry, I never shouted that out loud. And again, we can apply this to relationships too. Some people will give promise rings, right, to their partner at age 16. And they go off to go, we'll still get married. You go off to college. And, you know, we all know how that plays out. But no, some people commit to relationships without ever having actually been in other relationships. And I don't mean that in a funny way. It happens. And then they do come to college and they realize, oh my God, there's other human beings out there that I'm attracted to. Now what? Well, you've never even given your chance to explore. How can you commit to something if you've never even tried on anything else? It doesn't make any sense. Moratorium is the opposite of that. Moratorium is no commitment, but giving you a chance to explore different options. Philosophically, this is what the integrated core of Mount Union is supposed to do. By taking your foundations courses in different disciplines, the student will learn different perspectives in different fields. That's how we talk when we're in faculty. Yes, that's a good idea. Yeah, horrible. Yeah, we don't talk. Faculty, even faculty. Anyway, moratorium. And then achieved, you probably put the pieces together. Achieved is when you've done both. You've committed, but you've only committed after exploring. And according to Erickson, whether you agree with him or not, I just happen to. That's fine, you can disagree. Still raise you fairly. According to Erickson, you can never become fully achieved unless you've gone through moratorium first. Now we have some evidence of this in our lives. You don't need to write these down, but just so you know, in both directions. Some of you have heard this come out of my mouth before. How many, nationally, how many freshmen who declare majors? Because some people come in and decide. Actually, I always bond with those students because I can relate to them. Like, yes, you're you or me. I was undecided. But some students come in saying, yes, I am going to be an educator. That's my job. How many of those students who come in declared change by the junior year? And when I say change, I don't just mean like Luther and the Methodist. Like, no, we mean like a big change. Like, anyone know? You do? You're still going to say it?
Oh, no. What I mean is a nursing major. Yeah. It's not an education major.
Yeah. So that's exactly what we're talking about. Yeah. 80%. 80%. So I get it. They come in, they think they know. And some do. Bless their hearts. They do. They got it figured out. And I'm very happy for them. There's nothing wrong with that. But most don't. They think they do. But then they come to college and they start liking something else a lot more. Or what happens later, like they're like in their junior year and they do an internship in their job, and they're like, well, I know, no, this wasn't what I thought it was at all. And they realize they don't like it and they try to pull back. So that's some evidence there. We actually also have some evidence on the relationship side too. If you've taken that marriage and family therapy course, we talk about this a lot, but anyone know what the divorce rate is in this country? It's actually not. Well, it depends. It's about 24, 29%. It's actually not very high at all. However, if we look at different groups of people, we see very different numbers. The divorce rate, and this is actually just good life advice. I didn't mean to even talk about this today, but just know this. If you get married for the first time or get into a serious committed relationship, so you don't have to get married, but whatever it is, if you do that 25 and beyond, divorce almost disappears. It almost goes extinct. In fact, the rates of divorce for people who get married first time at 25 and over is about 14 to 19%. It's like very low. A lot of people hear that like, what? No, because it's 50%. If we look at 18 to 23 year olds, so people who get married between the ages of 18 and 23, the divorce rate is 65%. Just chew on that for a while. And it's not for like nefarious reasons. It's not like 18 to 23 year olds cheat on each other more or anything like that. When I meet these people in the therapy room, it's the same story every single time. I've changed. I don't know. We were perfect together. And it's true, they were. When they were 19, they were perfect. Ricky was the perfect guy for you in junior high. You danced the night away, and you made it all the way to senior prom. But what we don't think about a lot, and I think it's because it's been programmed into us so much, the 18 and you're done, right? 18, you're an adult. Lots of significant change happens in your life between the ages of 18 and 25. Lots of change. You become a different person. And that's what happens to these people. They evolve, they change, and they don't fit together anymore. And that's just reality. And so, anyway. But that's Erickson. That's why that just jives with me. Incidentally, his next stage is intimacy versus isolation, which is also about relationships. In other words, in his own way, Erickson was one of the first people to argue that you probably shouldn't get into a serious relationship and expect it to last unless you know who you are as a person first. That's essentially what this theory says. And I can actually save us some Seligman, and I'll just jump, because he doesn't talk much about this. So what's left? So most of your life, and think about it, doesn't that make intuitive sense? I hope you've had this experience, but have you ever been with someone? It doesn't have to be a romantic partner either. It can just be a really good friend. Or a good family. Have you ever been with someone and all that matters is being with that person? It doesn't matter what's happening around you. I just care. I don't care where we live. I don't care what we do. This makes me content. That's a good relationship. All right. So then what's left is something called the meaningful life. And the meaningful life is exactly what it says up there. Having a life that has some type of purpose to it. Whether that's through giving back, making some kind of impact. It doesn't mean you have to have a life and career where they build a statue of you someday. It just means that during your life, you feel like you are doing something that has a significant purpose. Erickson called this, the next stage actually, stage 7, is something called generativity versus stagnation. Generativity meaning you're giving back to the world somehow. And there's more than one way you can satisfy this. You can, having kids actually is one way. Well, depending on the kids. You know, we put them back. Having the right kind of job. Teaching, nursing, the helping fields. And that's not exclusive to that. Some, any kind of job you can, right? If you can find meaning and purpose in it beyond just the occupation. This is why so many people are unhappy in their jobs, because they don't feel like they're, they know they're making money from it, okay, and feeds my, but they don't feel like they're really doing anything with their lives. They feel stagnant. They feel like they're just existing. And this is the word people use. I feel like I'm just existing. Why am I even here? So the meaningful life, it's, this is the other part of life satisfaction. It's hard to see how this is possible, though, without the other one. Like the good life and the meaningful life kind of go hand in hand with each other. And just, I just put this up there. You don't need to write this down. But his last stage, by the way, Eric Erickson, something called integrity versus despair. So even in your final days, you're faced with one last emotional crisis. And he argued it's, if you realize death is near, you start reflecting and you're either satisfied. Here we go with life satisfaction. You either achieved life satisfaction and you can look back on your life. And I've actually been with people who are near death, they're older, and they're saying things like, it's fine. Like I don't want to die, but I've lived my life. I did everything I want to do. You guys are awesome. Like have you ever, I hope you've, or maybe you haven't had that experience yet, but if you do experience death with people, trust me, that's the best way to experience it. Because I've also seen the opposite, where people are just full of regret. And they wish they could go back and make this choice and this choice. Gosh, this sounds like a movie. It sounds like a story that I've heard. Psychology enters pop culture. This sound like, the story sounds familiar, Dominic, you're shaking your head. What does it sound like?
My grandpa.
Oh, you think of your own grandpa?
Yeah.
That's good. I mean, I'm sorry you died.
Yeah.
But he was, the integrity, is that your?
No, despair.
Oh, despair. Yeah. No, I feel bad.
It's like, I remember she was in the hospital. It was like the week where she came out of the coma.
Yeah.
And was completely lucid.
Yeah.
And then he like apologized to all his kids because he was kind of a shitty dad.
Yeah.
He apologized to his ex-wife, even though she, you know, didn't come to the hospital and he talked to him about it.
Yeah.
He apologized to everyone. It was like, I really messed up here. And like, I don't want to die now, but I don't know, like, screw
it. You can feel that need. He had this innate, like we have an innate desire to do this. So at least he had a chance to do that stuff. But is this, you ever heard a story of someone kind of like that? I mean, only maybe was presented with death at an early age. Maybe at an early age. This is a ghost. Yeah, see how this stuff forms its way into pop culture? This is an influence for that, right? Scrooge was faced with death, realized, oh my God, I've been stagnant. And what happened when he was given a second chance? He suddenly becomes the embodiment of generativity because he realized how important that is to his life satisfaction. He didn't realize, he probably knew he was miserable, but he didn't realize how miserable he was until he was given a chance to look what you could have done. And of course, in that fantasy world, he had the chance to go back and do it. So interesting little twist there. Oh, any questions so far? Because we're going to switch gears a little bit. So the three lives, what we're going to kind of segue into, and there's not enough time to finish it, but don't worry, there wasn't Tuesday either. We kind of got the ball rolling a little bit. But we're not going to completely put the dot on the I until next week. So you got some stuff to absorb on your own, those lectures with, that's the kind of the research on humor and specific things of mental health like anxiety and depression and coping with stress. So that's fun. That's out there. But what we're segueing in, which we'll finish next week, is interventions. How do we take normal people and make their lives happier? That makes sense. So that's what this last part of positive psychology is. And to get the ball rolling, well, here's a guy that will introduce you to them. We'll finish this next week. So I'm not putting this on the website, although you could look it up. Some of you have
when I was 7 years old and my sister was just 5 years old, we were playing on top of the bunk bed. I was 2 years older than my sister at the time. I mean, I'm 2 years older than her now, but at the time that meant she had to do everything that I wanted to do, and I wanted to play war. So we were up on top of our bunk beds, and on one side of the bunk bed, I put out all my G.I. Joe soldiers and weaponry, and on the other side were all my sister's Milos and ponies and ready for a cavalry charge. There are differing accounts of what actually happened that afternoon, but since my sister is not here with us today, let me tell you the true story. which is my sister is a little bit on the clumsy side. Somehow, without any help or push from her older brother at all, suddenly Amy disappeared off the top of the bunk bed and landed with a crash on the floor. And I nervously peered over the side of the bed to see what had befallen my fallen sister and saw that she had landed painfully on her hands and knees on all fours on the ground. I was nervous because my parents charged me with making sure that my sister and I played as safely and as quietly as possible. And seeing as how I had accidentally broken Amy's arm just 1 week before. Heroically pushing her out of the way of an oncoming imaginary sniper bullet. For which I have yet to be thanked. I was trying as hard as I could. She didn't even see it coming. I was trying as hard as I could to be on my best behavior, and I saw my sister's face as wail of pain and suffering and surprise, threatening to erupt from her mouth and threatening to wake my parents from the long winter snap for which they had settled. So I did the only thing my little frantic 7-year-old brain could think to do to avert this tragedy. If you have children, you've seen this hundreds of times before. I said, Amy, wait, don't cry, don't cry. Did you see how he landed? No human lands on all fours like that. Amy, I think this means you're a unicorn. Now that was cheating because there's nothing in the world my sister would want more than not to be Amy to her 5-year-old little sister, but Amy the special unicorn. Of course, this was an option that was open to her brain at no point past. And you can see on my poor, manipulated sister's face conflict. As her little brain attempted to devote resources to feeling the pain and suffering surprise she just experienced, or contemplating her newfound identity as a unicorn. And the latter won out. Instead of crying, instead of ceasing our play, instead of waking my parents with all the negative consequences that would have ensued for me. Instead, a smile spread across her face, and she scrambled right back onto the bunk bed with all the grace of a baby unicorn. With one broken leg. Well, we stumbled across. At this tender age of just 5 and 7, we had no idea at the time of something that was going to be at the vanguard, the scientific revolution occurring 2 decades later in the way that we look at the human brain. What we stumbled across is something called positive psychology, which is the reason that I'm here today and the reason that I wake up every morning. When I first started talking about this research outside of academia, out with companies and schools, the very first thing they said to never do is to start your talk with a graph. The very first thing I wanted to do is start my talk with a graph. This graph looks boring, but this graph is the reason that I get excited to wake up every morning. And this graph doesn't mean anything. It's fake data. What we found is... If I got this data back studying you here in the room, I would be thrilled because there's very clearly a trend that's going on there, and that means that I can get published, which is all that really matters. The fact that there's one weird red dot that's up above the curve, there's one weird in the room, you know who you are. I saw you earlier. That's no problem. That's no problem, as most of you know, because I can just delete that dot. I can delete that dot because that's clearly a measurement error. And we know that's a measurement error because it's messing up my data. So one of the very first things we teach people in economics and statistics and business and psychology courses is how, in a statistically valid way, do we eliminate the weirdos? How do we eliminate the outliers? So that we can find the line best fit, which is fantastic if I'm trying to find out how many Advil the average person should be taking, too. But if I'm interested in potential, if I'm interested in your potential, or for happiness, or productivity, or energy, or creativity, what we're doing is we're creating the cult of the average for science. If I ask you a question like, how fast can a child learn how to read in a classroom? Scientists change the answer to, how fast does the average child learn how to read in that classroom? And then we tailor the class right towards the average. Now, if you fall below the average on this curve, then psychologists get thrilled. Because that means you're either depressed, or you have disorder, or hopefully both. We're hoping for both, because our business model is that if you come into a therapy session with one problem, we want to make sure you leave knowing you have 10. So you'll keep coming back over and over again. We'll go back into your childhood if necessary, but eventually, what we want to do is make you normal again. But normal is merely average. What I posit, what positive psychology posits, is that if you study what is merely average, we will remain merely average. Instead of deleting those positive outliers, what I intentionally do is come into a population like this one and says, why? Why is it that some of you are so high above the curve in terms of your intellectual ability, athletic ability, musical ability, creativity, energy levels, your resiliency in the face of challenge, your sense of humor? Whatever it is, instead of deleting you, what I want to do is study you. Because maybe we can glean information, not just how to move people up to the average, but how we can move the entire average up in our companies and schools worldwide. The reason this graph is important to me is when I turn on the news, it seems like the majority of the information is not positive. In fact, it's negative. Most of it's about murder, corruption, diseases, natural disasters. And very quickly, my brain starts to think that's the accurate ratio of negative to positive in the world. What that's doing is creating something called medical school syndrome.
which if you know people who have been to medical school during the first year of medical training, as you read through a list of all the symptoms and diseases that could happen, suddenly you realize you have all of them. I have a brother-in-law named Bobo, which is a whole other story. Bobo married Amy the Unicorn. Bobo called me on the phone from Yale Medical School. From Yale Medical School, and Bobo said, Sean, I have leprosy. Which even at Yale is extraordinarily rare. But I had no idea how to console poor Bobo because he had just gone over an entire week of menopause. See, well,
that's a good place to stop. We're halfway through. So a different way, maybe more modern, exciting way of introducing positive psych than Martin Seligman put back in 2004. So I'll leave you with that. You got other stuff to do. And we'll wrap this up to begin